In this first part of the lecture covering pharmacology of antibiotics, we are going to discuss cell wall synthesis inhibitors and cell membrane integrity disruptors. But first things first, let's define antibiotics and let's classify them. So, antibiotics are broadly defined as chemical agents that kill or inhibit the growth of microorganisms. Antibiotics may be classified as broad spectrum, meaning they act against a wide range of microorganisms, or as narrow spectrum, meaning they act against very few types of microorganisms. Furthermore, antibiotics may be categorized as bactericidal, meaning they kill bacteria, or as bacteriostatic, meaning they only stop bacteria from growing. Selection of antibiotic depends largely on clinical manifestation of the infection as well as the patient profile, and it's often guided by the cultural sensitivity results. The Kirby-Bauer method is one of the most commonly performed tests that helps to guide selection of an effective antibiotic, while the dilution test is commonly performed to determine the lowest concentration of antibiotic that inhibits visible bacterial growth, known as minimum inhibitory concentration, or MIC, and the lowest concentration of antibiotic that kills at least 99.9% of bacteria, known as the minimum bactericidal concentration, or MBC. Now, let's dive a little deeper and take a closer look at how antibiotics work. So, based on their mechanism of action, antibiotics can be divided into five broad categories. Number 1, cell wall synthesis inhibitors. Number 2, cell membrane integrity disruptors. Number 3, nucleic acid synthesis inhibitors. Number 4, protein synthesis inhibitors. And number 5, metabolic pathway inhibitors. Now, let's discuss these one by one in detail, starting with cell wall synthesis inhibitors. So, the cell wall is essential for the growth and survival of bacteria. It gives the bacterial cell its shape and protects it against spontaneous cell lysis due to the high internal osmotic pressure that results from high concentration of proteins within the bacterial cytoplasm. The vast majority of bacteria have one of two different types of cell wall. The first one is called gram-negative, and it is composed of the outer membrane linked by lipoproteins to a thin inner layer of peptidoglycan. The second one is called gram-positive. It is composed of many interconnected layers of peptidoglycan, and it lacks the outer membrane. Now, peptidoglycan is what gives both cell wall types their rigid and protective qualities. It consists of glycan chains of alternating N-acetylglucosamine, NAG for short, and N-acetylmuramic acid, NAM, with short peptide chain attached to it. The biosynthesis of peptidoglycan is mediated by transpeptidase enzymes, also known as penicillin-binding proteins. Specifically, penicillin-binding proteins catalyze the final transpeptidation reaction that results in formation of bond between the last lysine residue of one peptidoglycan and the terminal alanine on the other strand. Now, in order for bacteria to grow and divide, a new cell wall must be continuously built this way. So this is where inhibitors of cell wall synthesis come into play. Most of antibiotics belonging to this group are characterized by beta-lactam ring at the core of their structure, which resembles substrate for penicillin-binding protein. When penicillin-binding protein binds to beta-lactam ring portion of the drug, covalent bond is formed, resulting in permanently blocked active site. This makes the enzyme unable to perform their role in cell wall synthesis, which in turn leads to death of bacteria due to osmotic instability or autolysis. Now, the beta-lactam ring is part of the structure of several antibiotic families, namely penicillins, cephalosporins, carbapenems, and monobactams. Collectively, we call them beta-lactam antibiotics. Here are some examples of beta-lactams. Due to the large number of antibiotics that belong to this family, keep in mind that this diagram is not meant to be exhaustive. So all looks good up to this point. We have all these powerful antibiotics that can easily kill all harmful bacteria, right? Well, not so fast. Unfortunately, over the years, exposure to antibiotics provided bacteria with selective pressures, which led to emergence of different resistance mechanisms. The most common mechanism for drug resistance to beta-lactam antibiotics is bacterial synthesis of beta-lactamases. Beta-lactamases are enzymes produced by certain types of bacteria that simply break the beta-lactam ring and thus destroy antibacterial activity. In an effort to fight back against this resistance, scientists were able to develop beta-lactamase inhibitors that irreversibly bind to and inhibit beta-lactamase enzymes. The use of beta-lactamase inhibitors in combination with beta-lactam antibiotics is currently the most successful strategy that we have to combat this specific mechanism of resistance. However, I would like to point out two exceptions here, which are carbapenems and monobactams. Unlike penicillins and cephalosporins, they don't need to be combined with beta-lactamase inhibitors because they have modified beta-lactam rings in their structures that provide them with significant resistance to beta-lactamases. Examples of beta-lactamase inhibitors are Avibactam, Clavulanic acid, Sulbactam, and Tazobactam. Now, when it comes to side effects, all beta-lactam antibiotics are likely to cause nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. In addition to that, small number of patients may experience allergic reactions ranging from mild rashes to life-threatening anaphylaxis. Now, beta-lactams are not the only antibiotics that interfere with synthesis of the bacterial cell wall. Four other antibiotics that you may frequently encounter, namely fosfomycin, cycloserine, vancomycin, and bacitracin, also disrupt cell wall synthesis. However, they accomplish that through a different mechanisms. In order to gain better understanding of how these antibiotics work, first we need to take a closer look at the enzymatic steps involved in cell wall synthesis. So, the first major step of the cell wall synthesis involves the cytoplasmic enzyme enol pyruvate transferase, abbreviated as MUR-A. MUR-A catalyzes the addition of phosphoenol pyruvate, abbreviated PEP, to UDP N-acetylglucosamine to form UDP N-acetylmuramic acid, to which then three amino acids are sequentially added. The next crucial step involves two enzymes. First, the alanine racemase that converts L-alanine into D-alanine, and the second, the alanine-D-alanine ligase that joins two D-alanine molecules, which are then incorporated into the growing peptidoglycan precursor. Next, with the help of translocase enzyme, peptidoglycan precursor is transferred to the lipid carrier called undecapranyl pyrophosphate, also known as bactoprenyl. This is followed by sequential addition of N-acetylglucosamine along with 5 amino acid molecules. Now, once this cell wall building block is transported across the inner membrane, penicillin-binding proteins catalyze the final step of polymerization of N-acetylmuramic acid and N-acetylglucosamine complexes via transglycosylation and cross-linking of chains via transpeptidation. Also, at the very end, the bactoprenyl lipid carrier gets dephosphorylated, which enables it to perform another round of transfer. So now let's go back to our four antibiotics and let's examine how they disrupt the cell wall synthesis machinery, starting with fosfomycin. So fosfomycin acts in the first cytoplasmic step of the cell wall synthesis by irreversibly inhibiting MUR-A enzyme. This in turn prevents the formation of peptidoglycan precursor and eventually leads to bacterial cell death. Our second antibiotic, cycloserine, comes into play at the next crucial step of the synthesis. Because of its chemical resemblance to D-alanine, cycloserine competitively inhibits both L-alanine racemase and D-alanine-D-alanine ligase. When both of these enzymes are inhibited, then D-alanine residues cannot be formed and previously formed D-alanine molecules cannot be joined together. Again, the formation of peptidoglycan precursor is disrupted, which eventually leads to death of bacteria. Now let's move on to our third antibiotic, that is vancomycin. Vancomycin belongs to a small family of antibiotics called glycopeptides that includes few other drugs that work in similar way. So unlike fosfomycin and cycloserine, vancomycin works in the late stages of cell wall synthesis. Specifically, vancomycin interferes with both transpeptidation and trisglycosylation during peptidoglycan assembly by binding to two D-alanine residues at the top of the peptide chains. This binding in turn prevents linking of long polymers of N-acetylmuramic acid and N-acetylglucosamine that form the peptidoglycan backbone, and it prevents cross-linking between amino acid residues in the peptidoglycan chain. Again, this brings cell wall construction to a halt, which ultimately results in bacterial cell death. Now let's move on to our last antibiotic, that is bacitracin, which comes into play at the very end of the synthetic process. Specifically, bacitracin works by binding to bactoprenol after it inserts the peptidoglycan into the growing cell wall. This in turn prevents the dephosphorylation of the transport protein, thus making it unable to regenerate and perform its job in construction of the cell wall. Now that we discuss mechanism of action of these antibiotics, let's briefly discuss their side effects. So the first one, fosfomycin, is most likely to cause nausea, dizziness, headache, and diarrhea. The second one, cycloserine, has been associated with neurologic and psychiatric disturbances such as peripheral neuropathy, depression, and psychosis. The third one, vancomycin, when administered intravenously, may cause hypotension along with flushing of the upper body, condition known as Redman syndrome. In rare instances, vancomycin may also cause nephrotoxicity, ototoxicity, and blood disorders, including neutropenia. Lastly, bacitracin, when used topically, rarely causes side effects other than minor skin irritation. However, when administered intravenously, nausea, vomiting, allergic reactions, and nephrotoxicity may occur. So the antibiotics that we discussed thus far typically are capable of disrupting cell wall synthesis in species of bacteria that are gram-positive or gram-negative or both. However, there is one more type of bacterial cell wall that presents a significant challenge to our antibiotic arsenal, that is mycobacterial cell wall. Mycobacteria are highly pathogenic organisms that are responsible for deadly diseases such as tuberculosis and leprosy. Furthermore, mycobacteria are notorious for their ability to resist most antibiotics. One of the main reasons for their toughness is their exceptionally impermeable cell wall. The mycobacterial cell wall is made up of five major components linked together: the inner plasma membrane, thin layer of peptidoglycan and arabinogalactan, surrounded by a thick layer of mycolic acid with a lipid-containing outer membrane. Now, because this cell wall is essential to the survival of mycobacteria, a couple of antibiotics has been developed to disrupt its integrity. The two agents that are thought to primarily target mycobacterial cell wall synthesis are well-known anti-tuberculosis drugs, Isoniazid and Ethambutol. Now, let's briefly discuss their primary mechanism of action. So the first one, isoniazid, is a prodrug, which upon gaining entry into the cell, it must be first activated by bacterial-catalyzed peroxidase enzyme called CatG. Once activated in the presence of NADH, isoniazid forms adduct, which then binds to and thereby inhibits the enol acyl carrier protein reductase, abbreviated as INHA. Now, INHA is a member of the type 2 fatty acid system, which elongates long-chain fatty acids for the synthesis of mycolic acid. Inhibition of mycolic acid synthesis in turn leads to a loss of cell wall structural integrity and physiologic function that ultimately results in bacterial cell death. Now, let's talk about our second drug, that is ethambutol. So the primary mode of action of ethambutol appears to be the inhibition of membrane-associated enzyme called arabinosyl transferase EMBB. This is the enzyme that mediates polymerization of arabinose into arabinogalactan, an essential component of the mycobacterial cell wall. So as a result of this enzyme inhibition, the cell wall permeability increases, allowing toxic substances to enter the cell. Now, when it comes to major side effects, isoniazid may cause hepatotoxicity and peripheral neuropathy, while ethambutol may cause optic neuritis that can lead to vision loss. Now, before we end this lecture, I would like to briefly discuss one more category of antibiotics, that is cell membrane integrity disruptors. Unlike cell wall synthesis inhibitors, cell membrane integrity disruptors target primarily the cell membrane of bacteria. Prominent members of this category include daptomycin and small family of antibiotics known as polymyxins. So now let's take a closer look at their mechanism of action. The first antibiotic, daptomycin, works by forming a complex with calcium that facilitates its insertion into the bacterial cell membrane. Next, daptomycin calcium complexes aggregate within the membrane to form pore-like structures that allow ions such as potassium to leak through, causing depolarization of membrane potential and eventually cell death. Now, in contrast to daptomycin, which targets cytoplasmic membrane of gram-positive bacteria, polymyxins target the outer membrane of gram-negative bacteria. Specifically, polymyxins initially bind to the lipopolysaccharides in the outer membrane, causing structural changes that increase membrane permeability. This in turn allows polymyxins to enter in and disrupt the inner cytoplasmic membrane, which then leads to leakage of the cell contents and eventually death of the bacteria. Now, when it comes to major side effects, daptomycin may cause skeletal muscle toxicity, while polymyxins may cause nephrotoxicity and neurotoxicity. And with that, I wanted to thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video, and as always, stay tuned for more.